it on 103, yes.
I beg your pardon. No, I don't want to make a motion.
So I thought we could take care of this at the end of the meeting.
I don't think we do.
We only voted to send back the proposed wetlands ordinance to the ordinance committee. We will take that up next Monday evening, and we will report back as an agenda item to the January 22nd town council meeting.
At which point, we could set a date for a workshop that can be televised.
That's correct. And at this point in time, the second public hearing has not been scheduled.
Okay.
So you don't need a motion? Okay. Everybody understand it? That's good. So we'll open up for a public hearing on the dog ordinance. Counselor Creelman, you want to hit any of the high points of the dog ordinance and hear any comments, or you're pretty well taken care of with the dogs?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is the fourth occasion, as the viewers and individuals here in attendance this evening, that we are going to be discussing revisions to our current dog ordinance. Let me very briefly go over the major changes so that everyone is clear about the changes. As you know, we did have the first of eventually two public hearings 2 months ago, so this is really the second follow-up public hearing this evening. As I go through the proposed ordinance, I will only refer to the specific changes. The first being Article 1, Section 712C. At large shall mean off the premises of the owner and not being under the control of any person by means of that person's proximity to the dog and their ability to manipulate and command the animal. What is being deleted is control by a leash, cord, or chain not more than 8 feet in length, or otherwise control by the owner or an agent of the owner, unless on other premises by permission of the owner or occupant thereof. So basically, this area is eliminating the length of leash and underscoring the responsibility of the owner for controlling the dog. The next major section, a new addition, is Section 71-3, entitled Failure to Display Tags. It reads as follows: it shall be unlawful for any dog owner or keeper to fail to have affixed to the dog's collar the license identification tag. Said tag must be displayed on a collar constructed of a durable material and sized so as to ensure the tag's attachment. Section 715, entitled Dangerous Dogs. What shall be deleted is the following: no person shall own, keep, or harbor any dog which has caused harm off the premises of its owner to any person or persons 2 or more times. And instead, what will be substituted as proposed is the following: procedures resulting in the disposal or method of restraint of an animal who has assaulted a person shall be as prescribed and required by Maine statutes annotated, Title VII and succeeding amendments. So this really, rather than the dog having caused difficulties 2 or more times, once would be enough. An entirely new section, Section 71-6, entitled Failure to Restrain, would read as follows: it shall be unlawful for any dog owner or keeper to fail to restrain such an animal, either by enclosed run, leash, tether, radio collar, choke collar, or voice command, so that the animal attacks, harasses, or menaces any pedestrian, jogger, cyclist, or passerby on any property other than that which is in the care and control of the dog owner. And lastly, and most importantly, the new section 7-1-7, entitled Dogs to be Restrained on Municipal Property. This is an entirely new section, and it would read as follows: any dog within the boundaries of a groomed and or regularly maintained municipal property, including but not limited to Fort Williams Park, public roads, municipal sidewalks, and athletic fields, will be walked on a leash or tether at all times. The person accompanying the dog in these situations is required to collect any feces dropped by the animal and dispose of same in an area where it will not likely be encountered by any person. The Cape Elizabeth Poor Farm, Lions Field, excluding the Little League Field, and a 20-plus acre portion of Fort Williams Park, southerly of Humphreys Road, that being the road fronting the park's maintenance building, and extending along a line to the rear of the long garages at the rear of Officers Row buildings, but excluding the fields immediately south of Portland Headlight and in front of Battery Blair, are not considered to be groomed and or regularly maintained for purposes of this ordinance. I also should note that groomed and or regularly maintained municipal property does include our two cemeteries. The specific addition of this 20-acre portion of Fort Williams Park that would be set up for the exercising of large dogs is the compromise section that was included based on our last public hearing to accommodate large dogs that need to be exercised. And I have personally discussed these changes with my own dog, a 98-pound golden retriever, and his girlfriend, Diana. They're both in agreement, and I think we may have a go at this particular time. The only additional area involves, actually the area, if we can get a better look here, that is marked off southerly of Humphreys Road. So on that note, I will give this back to my fellow counselors.
Thank you. Your dogs approve of that
Fort
Williams area that is allowed. So we'll, at this point, open it up to a public hearing. Does anybody out in the public care to comment one way or the other as far as the dog ordinance? Yes. Come to the podium, please. State your name. It would be greatly appreciated.
My name is Molly Stanley, and I live at 15 Stony Brook Road. I have many concerns regarding the proposed leash law. I think the town council's plan is misguided, both from a practical and philosophical point of view. First, the practical considerations. I would question whether or not your dogs have been on the proposed piece of land. The area proposed to be a leash-free zone in Fort Williams is too small. Furthermore, most of the proposed parcel is not cleared land, and the trees and bushes are too dense to walk through. In addition, there are crumbling foundations, an open well, fallen barbed wire, and rusted metal. In other words, it is unsafe for both dogs and owners. I have pictures that I took last Sunday of this area. None of them are duplicates of the same area that I'd like to give to you. The first one is about two-thirds of the cleared land is in this one picture. Then there's a few with foundations, which there's old foundations of a half a dozen, six to eight foundations, and some of them have crumbling bricks. There's very large pieces of rusted metal. They're just not safe for people or for dogs. And probably the most startling, which should be startling to parents as well, is an open well that is about this wide and a good 6 feet deep.
Thank you. Has anybody got a comment?
I have a few comments.
Okay.
Now the philosophical reasons for opposing this law. This law may seem at first glance a minor issue. I suggest it is not. I feel these are issues of man's trying to control nature once again. And once again, there will be serious consequences. Your proposal would, for all practical purposes, condemn the medium and large-sized dogs at Cape Elizabeth to a life comparable to living in a zoo. For surely to deny a dog a place to run is to reduce it to living in a cage. What kind of message is this to our children? I believe most deeply that when we isolate ourselves from animals, we lose the opportunity to learn about our human nature. I've been so interested tonight in listening to all about the concern in saving our wetlands, and yet the only animals that we have that, other than squirrels and maybe a few deer that we don't see very often, are our dogs, and we're going to restrict their movement. Although I would like to see that no leash law be passed, I would nevertheless like to offer a more acceptable alternative to the one currently under review. I've marked off on your map a larger area for a leash-free zone, basically the area to the right of the main road as you enter the park. This would allow the more populated areas along the water to be restricted areas. I've enclosed the map here, and I'd like to thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you. Anybody get a question, comment?
This is, well, see, what I'm proposing is all of the inside land.
Does that include like the parade grounds or the baseball field and
no.
everything?
No. Oh, it does?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought it was the
Portland
other one.
Symphony has there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
As,
okay.
As you enter the everything, park, all the area to the right of the road.
Everything to the right of the road.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you. Councilor Amaral.
Yeah, I want to thank you for bringing to our attention, particularly the open well.
Yes.
That's something that we have to address right now.
That's illegal. That's illegal on my place.
Unbelievable.
Did you know it was there? You know where it is?
We'll find it.
You'll find it? Because that's something that ought to be fixed. It really is.
Between snowstorms. Get Public Works to...
Okay, anybody else got a comment? Got a question? Okay, thank you. I'll take them. Anybody else?
My name is John Stanley. I live at 15 Stony Brook Road. I attended the last hearing, and I asked at the time for any objective results, complaints, whether the police department had anything, because we seem to be initiating this in response to some kind of outcry. I got a letter. I got prompt response. I got a letter saying the police don't hold or compile any complaints totals about dogs. So there's no answer to that. There's no, that I'm aware of, unless it's come in since then, there's no objective evidence to base this reaction on. So we're basing it, I assume, on subjective and anecdotal evidence. I've been asking everybody at the park, we live close to the park, and I've been asking everybody that I come across at the park if they've had any problems with dogs. And two people have responded in the affirmative. One was very strong and didn't want any dogs in the park, and the other said, yeah, he'd had one problem, but he really, you know, that was the only time, and he didn't really have any objections. I've talked to people in my neighborhood, unfortunately, two or three of them, kind of, they were here, but they left. They had to go home to go to work. But we've kind of canvassed Stony Brook and asked people, because we let our dogs run in the area, and we've asked people, are there any complaints? Please tell us, let us know.
No.
We've talked to, you know, about the kids. Same thing, I've asked neighbors. No. I still don't understand why we're doing this. I still can't get any reason as to what initiated this. I understand people say, well, we had a couple of complaints. I don't see the people come to the meetings. I don't come across anybody in the park. I don't even usually see people in that park, particularly in the winter. I just don't understand. I don't understand who's going to enforce this law. I don't understand, well, I just don't understand the need for it. It really upsets me because no one's able to sit down and tell me really why this is being done, and except to give their opinion as I'm giving mine. But I still haven't come across, there's been an increase in dog bites, there's been an increase in dog attacks, or what have you. I just don't understand.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody got a question? Anybody else from the public care to speak? Certainly. You want to come down to the mic and see yourself on camera?
That's great.
Good.
This is democracy in action. I'd just like to know, what are the provisions for enforcement and the penalties? If I'm walking my dog and my dog violates the law by leaving a deposit in a restricted area,
Will the chief's men give me a ticket? Will I be fined? What will happen? That's all I want to know.
Thank you. He's here and ready to speak after. Chief, could you respond to that and also about complaints and bites and so on and so forth?
The reason for the ordinance, to begin with, to answer the first gentleman's question, is as a result of a number of complaints that we did get. We don't have any formal record of complaints for dogs roaming at large. I can tell you that they increase, of course, proportionately in the summertime, mainly to people who are visiting the fort itself or the headlight itself and down in the area of the beach. Those are the primary areas of concern, and in the summer, those complaints do elevate. And it would appear that the only way that we can control those complaints is to control the dogs through an ordinance similar to the one that we have before us this evening. As far as enforcement goes, yes, my officers would be called down and upon violations of this. There might be some difficulty in determining or witnessing this activity, but certainly on complaint of another person, we have park rangers down there in the summer. They are able to give us statements which we would act upon. We would use in court to bring complaints forth. If convicted, and it's a civil ordinance, by the way, it's a civil violation, would be prosecuted through the town, through our town attorney or through officers in the department that have been approved for that. And the fine could be from $25 to $100, depending on the judge.
Okay, thank you. Anybody? Yes, Council Masterson.
In your estimation, Chief, would it be a good idea to make a list of complaints?
Well,
or would that be too difficult?
Well, it's a matter of, you know, if we have an officer that has stopped on the road and said, gee, there's a dog running at large, they bring that to my attention. Sometimes it's difficult to get statements from those people. As opposed to a formal complaint which might come before my office, you know, somebody come in to see me specifically. And we have had occasions of that nature. Matter of fact, one was as a result of an editorial that was in the Cape Courier and brought about a lot of calls to my office at that point. But certainly complaints of a more formal nature are entertained in my office as well as the complaints that the officers receive on the street. So it's a collective evaluation of those concerns that bring us to this ordinance.
The calls that you received after the Courier article, were they pro or con?
They ran about
doggy freedom.
They ran about 75% pro ordinance.
Okay, it's useful for us to have some indication of the support for this kind of a ordinance.
Anybody else? Council Coggeshall.
We also had several letters written directly to various members of the council requesting that we review the ordinance and possibly tighten it for various reasons, too. And I think that's what precipitated that article in the Courier.
Right.
So it's not just something that we decided to do because we didn't have anything else to do.
Thank you. Anybody else? Thank you, Chief. Anybody else from the public? Therefore, I'll close the public hearing at this time, and we'll move on to item 104. To consider a proposed dog ordinance and take any necessary action. What is your wishes? Do I hear Council Coggeshall?
I move that we accept and approve the ordinance as proposed.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Anybody got any comment? Councilor Torrey.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, I wanted to just direct this to the manager, if I could. In light of the woman that's come forth with the pictures, you know, that are quite revealing to some extent, and I think a point has been very well taken with the pictures, do you think that some energies can be put into, as spring approaches and we really start to get into more people will be utilizing this area, hopefully some cleanup of that so that there could be maybe longer expanses of run without, you know, having to worry about foundations and old dumpsters, et cetera, because I think the point is well taken there. If we can start to expend a little bit of public works' energy in that direction, I think it would be a good
answer that question two ways. First of all, the pictures omitted the large open field that's behind the heavy equipment building at Public Works. That field was not shown. That extends down to the road that loops around the lighthouse. So there is, in fact, already an open area. As far as cleaning up some of the other areas, it's been the Fort Williams Advisory Commission's belief, and I think it's been expressed at the council at different levels. I remember back when Steve Simons was on the council, that we ought to leave that back area as natural as possible. And, you know, not do cuttings of trees and that sort of thing. The foundations still are there from a number of garages that, that could be removed, that were removed. Obviously, those, you know, could be removed at some point. It might take a little bit of money, but it could be done. In addition to that, you can see there's an old, it almost looks like a tank in one of the pictures. That is up in an old area, up in the middle of some area with trees. And the committee has talked at times about removing all of that. And the equipment there is just so heavy to get out, and trying to get equipment in there to remove it, they just haven't felt it was a high priority. But that's the best I can answer your question.
Okay, I just want to say from my perspective, I would certainly hope and urge you to put some energies into it, even if there is some expenditures involved in cleaning up the debris. I don't mean going in and cutting open lanes or whatever, but in things that could be dangerous to dogs running or people walking. Those kinds of things have got to be removed. I mean, we're not trying to make this a token area for people just to say, here, we gave you something. I want to make it a safe area. And I know there's a large field, but I think these other points are well taken, that let's make it, you know, reasonable for the citizenry, you know, in terms of safety. So I hope that you'll follow through. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilor Coggeshall.
Councilor Creamon's
here. Oh, I thought you was first. Councilor Creamon.
Well, I would just echo, you know, Frank's comments about the field. And I would hope that as soon as possible, certainly the well area, that 6-foot deep well that I didn't see when I walked the area, you know, would be somehow boarded up it certainly is a liability and a hazard at the moment. And I would hope that that particular area would be addressed as soon as possible. I mean, the park is closed right now, but as of tomorrow morning, I would hope that that area is fixed almost immediately.
Should be filled in. Councilor Coggeshall.
I was just going to say that no matter how we vote on this ordinance, since that park is our liability, our responsibility, that that area should be addressed because it is open to the general public.
Thank you. Anybody else? Councilor Greenlaw.
I have a question on how we're going to be posting this area. I was out there a couple of weeks ago running a large dog. I was not in the right area. I would have been in violation of this ordinance. And I'm wondering how we're going to address letting people know where the area is.
There will be signage placed up, but as I indicated before, there's no guarantee that it will stay. I would also like to point out, I think maybe it's being lost in this, is that, you know, that there be no misunderstanding, that dogs are still allowed in the rest of the fort. Only they have to be on a leash, so it's not. I've done a lot of observing since this came up at the last meeting, particularly during the winter. There are an awful lot of people there with dogs, and every place else in the fort, the dogs can still go. But in these areas where there is the more open restriction, we will try to post it, but give no guarantees that the signs will stay in place.
Yes, Councilor Masterson.
Perhaps we could have the map published in the Coria.
We will ask them to do that, but they make those decisions on their own.
But ask them. If they would publish it for the fort anyway, if not the other places too.
Okay. Anybody else? I have a couple of comments that I would like to make, and I agree with what has been brought up in the past, that well should be filled in, taken care of very quickly. I understand, according to state law in my place, that any old wells have to be covered and secured properly or filled in, and or you could be fined, so maybe the town is exempt, I don't know. Also, I agree with the lady that spoke that I would think in between snowstorms here and what have you that maybe the public works could go over there and some of that wooded area that was showed in the picture could be brushed out and some of the dead wood and what have you, and that would give a dog a much better chance to scoot around through the bushes and what have you. And I don't think it would add a big expense to the fort budget or to the town budget, because I think that there is a few hours every once in a while and a day now and then could do quite a lot over there as far as cleaning up that area and hauling off some of that iron and cement work and make for a better place for the people that want to use that area. And also, you haven't got to clear cut the place. Clean it out and make little paths in there and what have you. I don't think it would hurt it a bit. Some people would like to run around through there. That's my comments. Anybody else got any comments? You all ready for the question? All understand the question? If so, raise your hand.
For what?
Item 104, to consider the proposed. I thought I had a motion to approve.
You do.
I do. I didn't know if I got lost.
Are we voting?
Yes.
We're voting.
You understand the question, you vote. Okay? Thank you. 7-0. Thank you.
Well,
105, to consider enacting an emergency ordinance relating to manufactured housing parks and taking necessary action. Mr. Manager.
This draft was prepared by Michael Hill of the town attorney's office. I'll briefly highlight it, but Tom is also here, the town attorney, Tom Leahy, if you have any questions. Basically, what this does, it would bring us into at least temporary compliance with the new manufactured housing law of the state of Maine that went into effect on January 1st. It amends several sections of our ordinance. First of all, the subdivision ordinance. It would add a definition there for manufactured housing park, which would conform with the definition that's also in the zoning ordinance. It would establish additional requirements for manufactured housing parks in relation to certain screening requirements, in relation to a setback of 50 feet from any external boundary, in relation to setback from existing streets. It would require that all fuel oil supply systems be either in the foundation, within the foundation, or underground, and that it be in accordance with all applicable codes and regulations. Trash containers, et cetera, would have to be screened, and if it was a public road, the width of it would have to be at least 23 feet, the right-of-way and the roadway pavement would have to be 20 feet. However, it could be narrower if it was, in fact, a private road in a manufactured housing park, and there's a provision in here for that. That is, it also provides that this be effective as an emergency ordinance. That's what is on, what is page 6 of the facts at the top, which means it would remain in effect for 90 days. It also proposes several amendments to the zoning ordinance. It defines manufactured housing park, and this conforms with the definition that's in the state statute. It also defines lot. In Residence A districts, we currently allow manufactured homes. They would continue to be allowed. There'd be a couple additional standards placed on them. I do call your attention specifically to on this page 8, paragraph 6. Excuse me, in the second line, fuel oil supply system shall be constructed and or installed within the foundation wall or underground. The word or there should have been crossed out at the end of that sentence. And then it should read, in accordance with all codes and, applicable codes and regulations. Must also meet all fire codes. Under this proposal, manufactured housing parks would be allowed in the RC zone, which are the more heavily developed areas. It then lists, again, conforming with the statutes, the purpose, the dimensional requirements, the manufactured housing park lot size, again, in conformance with the state law, would be 6,500 if the lot was served by public sewer, 20,000 if it was on an individual septic system, and 12,000 square feet if it was on a central on-site subsurface disposal system. There's a minimum street frontage of 50 feet. There's a 20-foot front setback, a 20-foot rear yard setback, a 10-foot side yard setback. Lots within the shoreland area would have to comply with those regulations. And that's essentially, and again, this would be promulgated if you adopted it as an emergency ordinance. The planning board is continuing to review the possibility of a permanent ordinance, and they're having a workshop on that tomorrow night and would hopefully get a recommendation back to the ordinance committee and to the council. So I would recommend that you adopt this as an emergency ordinance and refer the issue to the ordinance committee. If you do not adopt it, it essentially leaves the entire community open for proposals for mobile home parks, manufactured housing parks.
Thank you. Any comments?
I'll move adoption of the ordinance.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Does anybody have any comment? Yes, Councilor Amaro.
Just a question for Mike. If this passes tonight, We will be in compliance with state law.
That's our opinion, correct. We have, this is an emergency ordinance, it's effective for 90 days. Within the next 90 days, you'll have to do something in addition. Here we have manufactured housing parks allowed in all of the RC district. Obviously, some communities are trying to be more specific in the areas that they are allowed. But I guess the thought, the process here was to have something in place as soon after January 1st as you possibly could. Yes, it's our opinion being compliance as of that time. That it becomes effective, and I assume it would be immediately.
Councilor Masterson.
Thank you. Tom, it seems to me I've read in the newspapers about some dissatisfaction in some towns with the lot sizes. Do you foresee any efforts to change those numbers in the session?
I anticipate there'll be changes in this whole area because the comments coming from most communities is that they don't like the state mandating this sort of land use requirements on the town and basically telling the town that regardless of who comes in and proposes what, you shall designate where they should go. A lot of them feel that a lot of communities are stating that it takes away their flexibility of dealing with these issues. So I think it's evidenced by the fact that many of the communities haven't adopted this ordinance. I mean, it's all been put on the back burner for a lot of communities in anticipation of changes that may be coming along. So I do anticipate some changes. I think they lobbied hard for this change, and it may have been more than a lot of communities want. They may get together and propose amendments.
I can't understand how it passed.
Yeah. A lot of
I really can't. And I would think it would be quite a lively issue, and it may be something that Maine Municipal Association jumps on.
I think we'll hear more in the next few months on that.
Thanks.
Okay, Councilor Amaral.
It just seems interesting to me that all of the communities who have been addressing this issue have been having all these public hearings and all kinds of public concern about where the manufactured park's going to be. And here we have tonight an emergency ordinance, and nobody interested, I guess. And it's all right to pass an emergency ordinance without a public hearing at all.
You're having.
Yes.
Well, it wasn't listed as a public hearing. I mean, it's on the agenda, but it's not listed. I mean, it wasn't advertised as a public hearing.
That's the nature of it. That's why it only can last for 90 days without the full public hearing.
Without being reinstated.
Councilor Creelman.
Mr. Chairman, my understanding is that the motion as proposed as an emergency would need a minimum of 5 affirmative votes to be in effect as of this evening for the 90-day period of time, during which period the emergency ordinance would be referred back to the ordinance committee for its re-presentation to the council in March, hopefully, for a regular non-emergency vote that then would be in effect 30 days from that vote.
That's correct.
You'd still have to go through the process.
Process.
Having a public hearing, and also it'd have to come back for us pretty quickly.
Mr. Chairman, we could also continue the emergency ordinance. We could
readopt
it.
With readopt.
As an emergency a second time.
Yeah, for a specific number of days.
Okay. Councilor
Vittori. I'll just go on record as also voicing my distaste for having to vote for this type of thing and feeling it's beyond the jurisdiction of the state. And if this is a way of trying to get at the affordable housing problem, I think it's highly ineffective. So I'm voting reluctantly on this only because it's a state mandate.
Well, you see in the paper today that Cape Elizabeth is listed under the non-conforming communities along with a number of other
communities. Caused great pride to swell in my chest when I saw that.
But I just want to say, so this will come back to the ordinance committee, I take it at such and such a time, because there's one part of it that I think is could be very expensive, and I think it's discouraged by the state as far as putting underground storage tanks for fuel oil and what have you underground. I mean, you can do it, but it's quite stiff rules and regulations, but they have a choice to do it. And I think that should be discouraged, period, to put them on the ground outside regardless, but we can take that up at the ordinance committee. And in your motion, if I remember correctly, did I, that it was going back to the ordinance committee? To the at a emergency ordinance?
No, I didn't. I didn't mention going back to the...
To go into the ordinance committee?
But I'll add it if you want me to, Mr. Chairman.
Well, I think it should be added that it then referred to emergency ordinance and referred to the ordinance committee.
I'll second that addition.
Okay. Everyone understand the motion? All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? 7-0.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Councilor Coggeshall.
I would like to know when the new ordinance committee is going to be seated.
I didn't quite get that.
When is the new ordinance committee going to be seated?
June 1st, 1990.
Well, how about February 1st?
Item 106, 10:45. We're supposed to be done by 11. We'll move these right along. Item 106, to consider amending the church provisions and taking necessary action. Everybody received a little memo in your packet, and I believe the manager has a couple of comments he would like to make, and then we'll move on.
I would love to, and I'll try to keep them brief. This issue is one I brought before you a year ago and didn't have the greatest success in trying to get them amended. I'm giving it another try, and we'll see what happens this evening. Essentially, a number of changes in the first paragraph. It is just a style change to change the word flavor to character. It just reads better. In the third paragraph, this is the one that was so troublesome last time to the town council, and it's been loosened up quite a bit in this draft. And what it provides is the church would be available to rental to past and present Cape Elizabeth residents and to their immediate families. And immediate families is then defined as one of, for example, if it's a wedding for one of the two people getting married or one of their parents, brothers, sisters, children, or grandchildren, must be past or present Cape Elizabeth residents. The reason I advocate this particular provision is that the church is an extremely busy place. You have a sheet before you on the podium tonight that indicates that last summer, in the short period that the church is actually open during the year, we had 41 weddings. Of these, 17 were residents, 24 were non-residents. And this resident category is even, you know, a lot of the bride and grooms don't live in town, but one of their parents do. Just as the cemetery that is right next to the church, we only allow former Cape Elizabeth residents to be interred there because of the limited nature of the resource. I think you should look at a similar provision for the cemetery. Currently, already for 1990, we have over 20 weddings reserved. And what happens is people call, you know, from now on, who are Cape Elizabeth residents, and are very disappointed to hear that non-residents have already signed up for the church and they can't get in. And as you can see, last year, well over half were non-residents. So I would strongly urge you, in order to allow Cape Elizabeth residents the opportunity to utilize the church, to amend that section. In the next paragraph, I neglected to put in this copy here the draft of what you passed last year. That should read, it's already been adopted May 15th through the end of October, as opposed to the second weekend in October. I still don't necessarily agree with that policy, but I won't argue that one tonight. In the third paragraph on the second page, we'd had a problem with people serving wine and other beverages inside the church following ceremonies, and it's presumed to add no food or beverage, alcoholic or otherwise, may be consumed. This obviously would not include something used in conjunction with service, if it was communion or anything like that. But we have had cases of people having receptions in the back of the church after an event. Finally, it is in the last paragraph, a proposed amendment, and it's really administrative, but I don't know if it belongs in the provisions, but just encouraging people that they call us to confirm times. And it mentions Barbara Ray by name. Because what we found happens is people will change their time for their rehearsal and forget to tell us. It's happened a number of times. So I would encourage you to adopt the provisions for use. I should mention that anyone who has reserved it or has made an inquiry that's recorded, which we, Barbara's just been penciling in, people who have called and asked about a certain time, those folks all would be grandfathered. We wouldn't, someone halfway through the process, tell them that they no longer could use it.
Councilor Coggeshall.
Well, since this is going to be sort of a statement of the policy for managing the church, could I just amend that last paragraph to read, to call the manager's office? I know Barbara will probably be working with us for many, many more years, but I just think it's better not to have an individual person's name there.
Everybody in agreement with that?
Move it.
Councilor Latorre.
Okay, just for clarification then, this is a fairly major change in policy regarding the rental of the church in that a non-resident may no longer rent it for a wedding, whereas at this moment, a non-resident may rent it for a wedding. Is that correct?
Right now, anyone can reserve it, and we get people from New York calling.
That's right.
Okay, I just want to go on record as opposing this. I believe that I would be willing to compromise to the point where if after a certain period of time, no resident has selected a date, that date may open up for a non-resident, for instance, a six-month period or something that's reasonable in terms of planning a wedding. But to let certain dates sit vacant when a non-resident might have elected to rent our facility is extremely a waste of a good resource, in my opinion. And I don't believe that the cemetery analogy holds, because that's a very finite resource. There's just so many number of plots, whereas there are days that I'm sure that go by when it goes unrented that a non-resident may well utilize it. I don't believe that it's exclusively for the use of Cape Elizabeth residents. I think that's being overly protective of it and overly exclusive of it. And I don't believe that it's good policy.
Councilor Amaral.
I would agree totally with what Frank said. I think using that facility for 41 weddings a year is not in any way overusing the facility. I mean, after all, most churches are used on a daily basis. This one is used very, very rarely. Maybe it's used two or three times on a Saturday or a Friday afternoon, but I don't think that that is overuse of a community facility. I also think that it would be very elitist of us to exclude people who live just beyond our borders, say in Scarborough, and look at that church over the marshes, or who live in South Portland or Portland and who would like to be married in that church, to exclude them just because their parents never lived in Cape Elizabeth. I just would never vote for a policy like that. However, I agree that if we could set up a time frame where Cape residents could have first opportunity to reserve a time and then open it up to everybody, I'd be in agreement to do that.
Thank you. Councilor Greenlaw.
I also have a problem with the perception and the reality of exclusiveness that this.
Counselor Masterson.
I'm wondering if it's even legitimate to charge two different prices.
We do contribute tax money to the church in addition to the income we bring in.
I think it would be, in my opinion, I would go for the two prices, out of town and in town, because as the manager just said, you provide tax money also to the church, residents of the town, so the Counselor Coggeshall.
I just wanted to follow up on a comment that the manager made about the Black Point Inn calling and making reservations.
Yes,
I'm just wondering, perhaps it'd be better if we not let institutions or businesses make the arrangements. It has to be done by individuals.
Well, they make the arrangements and the initial contacts, and the people call us to confirm. But, you know, people call them, where can I get married? We've had, I'd say, 8 requests this year to get married inside Portland Headlight.
Inside? Do you grant
inside?
It's not a permitted
we don't
use.
Own them?
We don't. We haven't leased
we don't
it, and it's not a permitted
house.
Use in the concept plan.
Oh, in the lighthouse?
In the lighthouse.
Oh.
Up in
house.
The tower?
In the tower.
In the
who knows where.
Okay. Anybody else? Do I hear a motion? I feel similar to what the others. I'd like to see capable of residents use the church in some way that they could come first, which I don't quite see how they can and what have you. But so I don't think it's overtaxed at 40 some weddings a year. Quite an old landmark for the Jordans. So let the people see it. Counselor Coggeshall.
I would like to hear more comments from the council as a whole about trying to have priority given to Cape people, though, somehow. If there's an 18-month period or 12-month period, that after, say, the 10 months, I'm not sure how we'd work it out, but there must be some way that you can set up a period when it's opened up to the public, and they'll know, and they'll be waiting to take the slots.
Mr. Chairman?
Can't we move back? I mean, can't we move this and kind of workshop
why,
it sometime
why don't we,
instead of trying to do it right
why
now?
Why don't we? No, I'm just suggesting that we table it and let the manager try to come up with another format.
If I'm still Council here
Matheson.
In January 91,
I think just by publicizing this discussion and publicizing the popularity of the church, you know, and warning citizens that if they want to Cape Elizabeth citizens, they want to have their wedding in this Berwyn church, and they better hurry up and get their order in early. Don't you think?
That good idea.
That gives
That's right.
Cape people an edge.
Thank you. Councilor Torrey.
Well, did you have a comment? Because my motion may be
okay.
Yes, I was just going
putting
to,
an end to things.
Before a motion was made, I was just going to encourage you to decide if you wanted to approve anything else in there, or you wanted to kick the whole thing out, or if you're just objecting to that one paragraph and the elimination of the different.
I would be in favor of passing this, but the only changes, the only amendments would be character, would be no food or beverage, alcohol or otherwise be consumed, and the last paragraph. Passage of those three amendments.
Are you moving it?
Next year.
You got half the pie, Mike.
According to my clock on the wall, it is 11 o'clock. I feel if we're going to finish the agenda that we
have. 1 minute off. We have 1 minute to introduce.
You won't take care of the next one in a minute. Right? So you want to make a motion that we go beyond the 11 o'clock deadline?
So moved.
So, second.
All in favor? Raise your hand. Those opposed? You oppose?
No.
6-1. Okay, item 107, to consider amending the administrative code section regarding to appointment of deputy fire chief and taking necessary action. Are you after some?
No.
Mr. Manning.
I consider this to be housekeeping, although some may not see it that way. A little while ago, it was discovered that amongst all the different positions in town, that there appeared to be 3 positions that seemed to be permanent appointments without any possibility
for removal or for terms or for whatever. I wrote a memo that you see a copy of here to the fire chief, ask him to take it up with the Board of Fire Engineers, which is the advisory body that works with the chief. They met on December 13th to discuss it. A very clear quorum was present, including two of the three deputy chiefs. They unanimously considered it and recommended that the deputies serve at the pleasure of the chief, as they are appointed by him, and also at least once a year they'd be subject to an evaluation by the chief. I then looked at our administrative code and looked at that recommendation and tried to incorporate it within it. And my suggestion is that the administrative code be amended to provide that the deputy chiefs shall be appointed and add the words may be removed by the fire chief subject to the approval of the town manager, and to also add a sentence indicating that they are subject to an annual evaluation. So I would encourage you to adopt that provision.
Anybody got any comment? Yes, Councilor Creamer.
There's one more deputy chief that was not at that meeting.
Yeah, one of the three deputies was not present.
Have you received input from he or she about the issue?
No.
No.
Councilor Torrey.
Yes. Mr. Chairman, right now, is there neither an evaluation nor a reappointment? Is there any evaluation done now? Does this vary from what's happening now? Right now, nothing is happening. They're just appointed, and they go on and on, unless they majorly goofed up, and they'd be.
If they majorly goof up, I don't know what could be done. There's really no provision at this point.
But right now, they're not evaluated on a regular basis.
I think they have been evaluated at times. I know there's been discussions, but I don't think there's been written evaluations, and it hasn't been on a regular annual basis.
Anybody else? I have just one comment before I hear a motion. I see that you struck out, have their compensation set by.
Yes.
So who's going to set the compensation now?
It's set by the council through the budget process.
Set by the council through the budget process?
Right. That's why I eliminated that. I wouldn't want the fire chief going out determining the individual salaries. You know, it doesn't seem consistent with any of our other personnel practices.
Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Yes, Councilor Coggeshall.
I just wanted to make a correction, typo. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Right. It sixth line down. It should hold office instead of hold officer. Since we're It's an ordinance. And up above.
It's not an ordinance, is it?
Well, it's administrative code.
The administrative code.
And I guess Councilor Creelman has one. In the first paragraph, second line down on the right, have all
the rights
instead of the rights. Sorry.
Okay.
Fine.
Councilor.
I would move acceptance. Oh, okay. I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
Move acceptance.
I was going to say what you're saying.
To the amendments of the administrative code regarding deputy fire chiefs.
Second.
All in favor? Raise your hand. Those opposed? Seven to nothing. One more to go. Item 109. Consider.
Excuse me, 108.
Oh, excuse me, I marked things off wrong. Excuse me, sorry. I'm trying to move along here.
I appreciate it.
Item 108, consider a report from the town manager on the scheduling of the fall cleanup week and take in necessary action. You all got a memo from the manager and your public works director, and it's very informative, and I hope that you can pick out a date when the leaves are going to fall at the proper week, and make it agreeable to everyone. Your turn, sir.
I think the memorandum is self-explanatory. My recommendation is that you authorize the Director of Public Works to continue to schedule the weeks as at his discretion, his or her discretion, currently his.
Anybody got a comment?
These leaves, they just won't conform to our standards. You know, they fall whenever they want.
Somebody care to make a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Everybody understand the motion? All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? 7-0. Now we can move on to 109. Take care of the dogs. I thought this would be Councilor Freeman's. To consider the annual dog warrant and take any necessary action. You all received a copy of the dog warrant, and John Sibley is a dog officer, and he's the one that will take care of all the complaints and what have you as far as dogs go.
Pass them now.
Does the manager or the clerk have any comments?
I can't believe that the state of Maine would make a typo. I do believe that they have. I am referring to the second paragraph, I guess you'd call it. The owner or keeper of any dogs at the age of 6 months or more that are unlicensed in violation of Title VII, Section 3942, as amended, period. That is utterly meaningless, and I suggest that the word "are" was left out after unlicensed.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Mr. Manager, will you please write to the, who is it, would it be, Secretary of State, and inform him of this grave error?
Better to CC that letter to the Press Herald too, Michael, because this should not go into text.
I guess I don't read it that way.
I don't read it that way either.
It's not a sentence.
It's not a sentence.
Otherwise, it's not a sentence. You don't have a verb.
There's no verb.
In other words, they're saying that any dog 6 months or more that is unlicensed is in violation of Title VII. Section 3942 as amended.
It's the owner that's in violation.
Yeah, I think the error is the period, Mrs. Masterton.
Do you think so?
Yes, and then it should be a small t. If you start at the top of the paragraph, in the name of the state of Maine, you are hereby directed to proceed to Southern Cumberland App, Portland. You see, you're summoning the owner or keeper of any dog.
Whatever, it's very poor.
It is poor. I will call, what's the guy's name? Clyde LeClaire. We will notify him of your concern.
Mr. Chairman, I move acceptance of the edited dog warrant.
Second.
It's been moved and second. All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? Vote 7-0. Citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Do we have a citizen? Nobody's here.
Colonel. Brian.
What?
I'm just calling out the names of who's here.
Do I hear anybody have a comment they would like to bring up before we adjourn?
One.
Mr. Manager.
With two things, actually. In one of the memos to you, I indicated that the Vikings coming in for a 20-bed expansion. Mm-hmm. I found out after I wrote that it's actually a 60-bed expansion, or essentially doubling a proposed doubling of the size of the Viking. Secondly, you do have a workshop on the 22nd. My current intent is to put on the agenda, subject to further review with the chairman, the meeting that he previously discussed, as well as a review of the goals of the council, and hope to make it a planning session for the next 6 months for you to determine what your priorities are, what you as a council want to work on, and what you want me as the manager to work on.
Okay, thank you. Councilor Emerald.
I'd just like to make one last comment before we adjourn, but I just want to note that this is probably the shortest agenda we've had in months, and also the longest meeting. With that, I'd like to move we adjourn.
Oh, second.
All in favor? Raise your hand. So we're adjourned. Councilor Emerald, I had a comment for you. I am very pleased with what COG is trying to do to reduce the deficit.
Thank
and
you.
I think they are, looked hard, and probably it's going to be kind of hard on them. But I think it's a direction.